Good day. I'm going to present a paper for the QCD 2021 conference at Montpellier entitled Erasing Triangle Singularities in Relativistic Heavy Ion Collisions. This I've done in collaboration with Luciano Abreu, who is a professor at the Universidad Federal de Bahia in Brazil, and I myself am Felipe Llanes-Estrada at the University Complutense of Madrid. So what is this all about? Well, traditional resonances were found in hadron physics in simple reactions like this one, the rho, that appears in any pi-pi spectrum that can be produced by any means, but in the end you only have two particles that are rescattered and form a resonance shape. However, many new states in hadron physics have appeared in multiparticle reactions. This has been facilitated by the modern computing analysis and modern detectors. For example, not long ago, the LHCb collaboration claimed the found of these pentaquark states in JPSI proton spectra. I'm not going to go into detail. What's important for the purposes of this talk is that the supposed pentaquark is found in a reaction where a lambda B, an excited B baryon, decays into a kaon and this JPSI proton combination. So there are three strongly interacting particles in the final state. Well, it has been proposed that this JPSI proton construction is not really resonant, but it appears because of a singularity in a triangle diagram. Here the lambda B decays into a sigma sub C in a DS meson, a strange charm meson with minus charge. Now the D emits a kaon and becomes a D star zero, and the D star zero interacts with the sigma, the charm quarks recombine to give the J psi, and the proton is emitted. So this is a triangle mechanism, and if this diagram gives a singularity at some point, well, it might appear like a J-psi proton bound state or resonance. However, it would not be a resonant mechanism. It would be a singularity of this diagram due to some kinematic accident. Now, this particular case can be checked by Jefferson lab, and this is on the works. So you have a photon or a virtual photon hitting the proton and producing the J-psi and the outgoing proton, the scattered proton. Well, if there is a pentaquark resonance, it will be seen in this final state spectrum, J-psi proton, right? But there would be no lambda B and no kaon emitted, so the triangle mechanism would not be at work. So what we propose in this work is to use data from relativistic heavy ion collisions, for example from the Alice collaboration at the LHC, to check other triangle singularities that might appear like excited hadrons in other parts of hadron physics. So let me explain how these triangle singularities come about. Here on the left is a triangle diagram. State A decays into particles 1 and 2, Particle 1 emits state B and particle 3. Particle 3 collides with particle 2 and reconstitutes a new state C. Now I'm saying A, B, and C are states because they themselves might be multiparticle things. They don't need to be one specific particle. The triangle diagram, this I triangle here, is a four-dimensional integral in field theory, like any other loop. And in this case, it has three denominators. One with the particle of mass 1, another for the particle of mass 2, and another for the particle of mass 3. And I've routed the momenta so that P is the total momentum and Q is the momentum running inside the loop. Now, these denominators can be singular, so we're going to isolate the singularities in the Q0 integral. Now, integration smooths singularities, so the integral might be softer and not singular, unlike the denominators inside. For the integral itself to also be singular, so that it gives a peak in the cross-section, you need two conditions. All the particles need to be on shell, and the triangle scattering needs to be classically allowed. Well, in terms of the poles in the complex Q0 plane, what happens is if the poles of the three denominators are very separated, you can deform the integration contour. You know, you're integrating along the real axis in this plot, but you can deform the contour in the complex plane by adding an imaginary part of Q, avoiding the poles. Now, this is not possible if two of the poles pinch the contour. There is one right above and one right below the contour. It causes a threshold singularity. And if these two other poles pinch the contour, then you generate the triangle singularity. So we've said that all the particles have to be on shell. But what is this about the process being classically allowed? Well, that's an old theorem due to Sidney Coleman and Norton. And what happens is that for the integral to be singular, you need the process to be classically allowed. So at T0, particles 1 and 2 are emitted from state A and they fly off. At T1, particle 1 decays itself and emits B and 3. Now, particle 3 is collinear with particle 2, so the entire process is collinear, and it flies towards particle 2. And eventually, particle 3 catches up with 2, and they rescatter and form the final state system. Now, if this is classically allowed, that is, if all the particles can move in this way so that 3 catches up with 2 in a physical time, the kinematic allows this. This is an accident. It only happens for certain values of the energies, given the masses of the three particles. Then the integral can be singular because the two poles pinch the integration contour. That's the Coleman-Norton theorem. Okay, so now let's take this to relativistic heavy ion collisions. Here's the history of the collision. Time advances towards the top, and sideways is the different points along the collision axis. So the two beams are coming along the z-axis, meet here at the origin, and then the system expands. Now, after a little while, the quark and gluon plasma is formed, that's this orange band, and later on, a hadron gas is formed, and that's this blue band. So I'm going to be looking at this blue band. If the triangle mechanism, in the Coleman-Norton sense, that is, the hadrons are in flight, and they rescatter within the lifetime of the hadron gas, then we can expect the medium to affect the triangle singularity. On the other hand, if the hadrons fly off and the triangle mechanism is completed well after the system ceased existing, then we shouldn't expect the triangle singularity to be affected by the existence of the medium. To decide this, we have calculated a characteristic time, that's here on the right, for the triangle diagram. Now, this is a function, it's a complicated function, of all the kinematic variables of particles 1, 2, and 3 in the loop, and subsystems A, B, and C flying in and out of the triangle. Here's an example of a triangle singularity that is not affected by the medium because there is not enough time for it to happen. This is a singularity whose mass would be coincident with the renowned exotic meson X3872. Imagine that you start with a CC bar pair in the quark gluon plasma, and then you would have this decaying to this star, this star. One of the D stars would decay into a pion and a D, and that D would collide with the other D star to produce J psi pi pi. Now, under very precise kinematic values, this might peak. And we see here on the right, I'll explain the calculation later, that the effect of the medium is to broaden the singularity and make it less prominent. See, so that at 150 MeV of temperature, this blue line, it has completely disappeared. So the singularity would be affected by the medium. However, because the flight time, as calculated in the earlier slide, of this D star D triangle subsystem is of order 2000 Fermi, which is much bigger than 10 Fermi, the size of the heavy ion collision, it would just proceed as in vacuum. All right, now another important example where there is sufficient time for the medium to affect the singularity. This is the D star deuteron, or hexaquark, an example of an excitation of the deuteron. It appeared at 2380 MeV in the COMPASS experiment. Here is the data. Now, Molina and Osset proposed that this might actually be a triangle singularity in which two protons collide and form a delta excitation in the proton. The delta decays to a pion and a neutron, and the neutron and the proton form a deuteron. The mechanism is depicted here on the right. So you see a triangle of a delta, a neutron, and a proton. So we have tried our hand at putting this in thermal field theory. We find that the flight time is about 5 Fermi, and we see that this triangle singularity actually disappears. So as we increase the temperature from 0 MeV to 50 to 100 to 150, we see by the time we reach the top temperatures of this pion gas at the end of a hadron collision, the singularity is all but gone. So this would be a discriminant. So if you see this excited deuteron in a vacuum experiment, as we see it, but you do not see it in relativistic heavy ion collisions, it might be because it actually is a triangle singularity. So that's an example where actually Alice might make a contribution to hadron spectroscopy. Well, let me show you in 2 minutes how we calculate these things. First, let me remind you that the hadron gas at the end of a heavy ion collision is near thermal equilibrium. We know this from several observables. For example, here on the left we see the yield of different hadrons fitted by a statistical model. Basically, the temperature is the parameter, and it's 156 MeV. And you can see that pions, kaons, protons, and so on, the many species here depicted, have abundances consistent with a statistical model. Another observable is this very good fit of the PT spectra that you obtain at moderate PT, say up to a GeV. So both observables point out to the pions emitted at the end of the heavy ion collision being thermalized into a medium. So it is appropriate to use thermal field theory. Well, the first thing we do is to sum over Matsubara frequencies instead of integrating over Q0. So in the triangle loop, we substitute this construction, integral over dQ0, a function of Q0 and the vector Q, the momentum, by this Matsubara sum. And this would give us the effect of the temperature on the triangle itself. This is a first effect. While doing that, we reduce the triangle integral to this three-dimensional construction in terms of the momentum. There are some denominators, but what I want to remark here is these Bose-Einstein factors, 1 over e to the energy over the temperature minus 1, and beta. The interpretation of this construction is that one of the particles running in the loop has been actually lased by the medium where there are other bosons. So we emit particle 1 in this possible Feynman diagram, and particle 2 is taken from the medium. Well, the effect of this first effect of the temperature is very small, and we can see it in a singularity relevant for compasses A1-1420 production. This is an axial meson, and it has been suggested that it might actually not be a meson at all, but a triangle singularity, in which particle A goes by a loop with K star K minus K plus, and this ends up emitting a pion, which is the subsystem B, and then either two pions or a pion and an eta, which is the subsystem C. Why this suspicion? Well, A1-1420 is too close to the conventional A1-1260, and the conventional QAR model cannot accommodate two axial mesons lying next to each other, so closely in mass, and also this meson is narrower than typical mesons of that mass. So we have run our computation at finite temperature, and here we see how this triangle singularity in the box, with a k star and two kions in the loop, is affected by this first effect of the temperature inside the medium. Well, not a lot. As you can see, between 0 MeV and 150 MeV, the peak almost doesn't change. Well, the second effect we're going to take into account is the in-medio masses and widths. So you see here the diagram. Now we're going to, in addition to the effect before, that's still taken into account and we use the same loop integral, but now we're going to change M1, M2, and M3 by the mass of each of the particles in the medium, for example here, particle 2. And also we're going to change the I epsilon in the denominators by the actual width of the particle, because they acquire a temperature-dependent width. It is very well known that the spectral functions broaden because it is more likely that they decay in a medium. There is ample work on this mass and width in a medium, so we just take it from the literature. For example, let's look at this kaon mass. The charged kaon has a mass of 0.494 GeV in vacuum, but by the time you get to 150 MeV of temperature, it's down to 0.37. So it's quite different. And now this change of the mass and the width of the particle erases the triangle singularity. So this is again the same singularity with two kaons and a k star in the loop. And you can now see that upon including the effect of the kaon masses, it changed a lot. It went from this sharp peak here at 0 MeV to this green line at 100 MeV down to a line that's almost disappeared at the bottom at 150 MeV. And we see the same effect for the other examples and some others that are cited in our paper. Well, a very interesting exemption is the pion. If you have a pion in the triangle loop, we see basically no change in the triangle singularity. And this is, of course, because the pion mass barely moves with temperature. It goes from 139, this is a charged pion, to 144. And that's not enough to affect the triangle singularity too much. Very good. Let me turn to our conclusions. Relativistic heavy ion collisions can help distinguish resonances, ordinary hadrons, from triangle singularities, which are very much talked about these days in hadron physics, by simply erasing these last ones. This is due to the thermal width and the shifts of the masses of the particles in the loop. This happens provided the triangle and the medium lifetimes are comparable. It remains to thank the organizers of the conference, especially Professor Narison, and our sponsors that are listed in this page. Thank you very much.